Hello?
Paula, morning.
Good morning.
Hello, Paula. It's Edith. Welcome to our meeting.
All right, I'm very happy to be virtually there.
So, we see now your transparencies. Yes, boomerang again. And in principle, I think you... Oh, it's okay. Your title page is on our screen, Boomerang and Game, Paolo De Bernardis, University of Roma. So you're welcome to start your presentation.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll start by describing what Boomerang is going to do and what it has done in the past. Boomerang is a cosmology experiment. And if you look at the slide number 2, you see a few words about the cosmic microwave background. This is the radiation which comes from the early universe, and precisely it comes from the epoch when protons and electrons first combined into hydrogen atoms. This is the so-called recombination. About 13.7 billion years ago, and about 380,000 years after the Big Bang. Radiation coming from the recombination has a redshift of about 1,000, and since at the combination of nitrogen the temperature had to be about 3,000 Kelvin, now the temperature of this black body radiation is 2.7 Kelvin. If we look to figure number 3, we see that the cosmic microwave background has a spectrum which is precisely a black body at 2.725 Kelvin. And this is measured with, very high accuracy by the FIRAS experiment on board of COBE. And also, this radiation is very much isotropic over the whole sky, as has been measured since the COBE DMR measurements about 20 years ago. And this measurement has then improved a lot. And when we look in detail at the image of the cosmic microwave background, now we see very faint structures, very faint anisotropy of the cosmic microwave background. What do we expect to see there? If we look at slide number 4, The first thing we have to see there is a cosmic horizon, because this very good isotropy of the cosmic microwave background is a bit surprising, because on different directions in the sky, we see regions of the universe which are separated more than 380,000 light years. Since we see these regions as they were about 380,000 years after the Big Bang, these regions we are seeing now were not in causal contact at that epoch. So we don't understand why they have the same brightness in the microwaves, why they produce the same emission of microwaves, why they have the same temperature if they are not in causal contact. And if we look at slide number 5, here you see a sketch of what we do when we look at the cosmic microwave background. We look very far away, so we look in the past of the universe, and we look all the way where the universe becomes opaque. This is the recombination epochs, because we look so far away that we look so long ago in the past that the universe at that point was very hot and ionized, not transparent. So we look at the sphere, the sky, the radius of the sphere is about 14 billion light years, and this sphere, if you look at page number 6, contains regions which are separated by many, many billion light years, and these regions, if you look at slide number 7, are small causally connected region with respect to the size of the sphere we're looking at. So if you look at slide number 8, you see that there is a problem. And in slide number 9, you see the sketch of the problem. The size of the horizon, of the size of causally connected regions increases as time, while the size of the considered region increases slower, increases faster before and slower after. So in a universe made of matter and radiation, the expansion rate decreases with time, so this, you see these two different behaviors of the size of the horizon and the size of any given considered region in the universe. So if you look at number 10, a region as large as the horizon when the CMB is released, in line number 11, you see that it has never been causally connected before to the surrounding regions. This is a problem. And in slide number 13, we call it the paradox of cosmic horizons. So, how was this temperature of the cosmic microwave background, so the temperature of the early universe, regulated so well everywhere from the very beginning? This is the problem, and this problem is solved, or we think is solved, the best solution we have for this problem is cosmic inflation, as stated in number 14. Cosmic inflation is a superluminary expansion of space driven by a phase transition about the energy of grand unification, very early in the expansion of the universe. And in slide number 15, you see that you see the same plot as before, but if you zoom to the very beginning, near the origin of the plot, in number 16, you see that inflation, this exponential expansion, solves the problem, because regions which are not causally connected when the CMB is released have been causally connected before inflation. So, what we can do to test this hypothesis? In number 18, you see a list of pros and cons of inflation. Inflation provides a physical process to origin density fluctuation, like the quantum fluctuations in the very early universe. Explains the flattens at the horizon of paradoxes, explains both of these paradoxes, and it's also a predictive theory, because predicts Gaussian density fluctuations, K-invariant density fluctuations, a critical density of the universe, and the production of gravitational waves during the inflation phase. So there are several ways to test it. And the one is of interest here for the boomerang experiment, for the CMB experiments, are more than one. But the first one is that we expect anyway that the scale of the causal horizon is imprinted in the image of the cosmic microwave background. And if you look at number 19, you can do a very rough calculation of how large should appear today one of these cosmic horizons in the cosmic microwave background. and the angle is about 1 degree. So we need experiments with this angular resolution if we want to start the impression theory. We can skip all the way to number 29. In slide number 29, there is a picture of the boomerang experiment, which was the first experiment which was able to take a real image of the cosmic micro on the ground with a resolution sufficient to resolve cosmic horizons in the cosmic micro on the ground. And in number 30, you see how the experiment was set up. It's on the left panel, you see the general view of the experiment, and you see in general a lot of shields, the sun shield, the ground shield. We are going to look at the cosmic micro on the ground, but the anisotropy is very small. The variation of the temperature we wanted to see is of the order of a few microkelvin, while the ground and the sun emit like 300 Kelvin black body and 6000 Kelvin black bodies. So we need to shield very well our telescope. Inside the shields, on the right part of the picture, you see how the instrument is. There is a cryostat, which includes 16 detectors in the first implementation of the instrument. The micro of the ground coming from the sky is focused in the cryostat by the primary visor, which is 1.3 meters in diameter. And the whole instrument scans the sky floating at 40 kilometers of altitude, attached to a giant stratospheric balloon. So this is to avoid atmospheric emission and fluctuations. In number 32, you see a few pictures of the first flight of Boomerang. And in 33, you see the balloon, which is inflated, and then flies over Antarctica. In slide number 34, you see the path, the trajectory of this flight, an almost complete boomerang flight, really, which lasted for 2 weeks, allowing us to produce the map of the cosmic micro on the ground, which is shown in slide number 35. So here you notice that there are fluctuations of the order of 100 microkelvin of temperature, and the typical size of the hot and cold spots in the image is about 1 degree. The black circle in the lower right position is half a degree, like the moon. And you see that the spots in the image are about twice that size. If you do a real Fourier transform or spherical harmonics transform of this image, you find that indeed the maximum of the fluctuations is at angular scales of about 1 degree. This is shown in the plot in slide 37, where you see a peak of the fluctuations at an angular scale of 1 degree. And an angular scale of 1 degree is exactly what you expect in a universe with a flat geometry and with critical density. These measurements were published in the year 2000 and then were repeated by many other experiments. In slide number 38, you see which was the situation in the year 2003 with a confirmation of the boomerang data by the WMAP. experiment which observed the whole sky for many years, has been only recently closed, the W observatory. We can skip now to slide number 41, where you see the map of Boomerang and the maps, map of the whole sky by WMAP, and the features of these degree scale fluctuations in the cosmic microwave background are evident in over the whole sky. Now, this has several consequences for cosmology. In the next slide, 42, you see the power spectrum of the fluctuations with a sequence of peaks, and these peaks are due to the acoustic oscillations happening in the photon baryon plasma before recombination. And if you fit this trend with a cosmological model, you are able to constrain the densities of radiation, normal matter, dark matter, and dark energies, which are the four components of the universe. To do this, you need the inflation hypothesis. The next slide, you see the Planck instrument, which is now flying in the Lagrangian point L2 of the Sun-Earth system, and is taking data as we speak. We have published a few days ago the first set of papers on the web from Planck. These are all the early release data on galactic sources and so on, which show how well Planck is working, but Planck is inherited a lot from Boomerang, inherited the telescope, inherited the bolometer detectors. So it's very important to, this is a general comment which I like to do, is that it's very important to test on balloon flights critical technologies which we invent later used in satellite experiments. Now, if we want to go and to understand more of cosmology, there is something which Planck is not well equipped to do, and this is the measurement of the polarization state of the cosmic microwave background. And as you see in figure 45 is a nice picture of a blue sky. This picture is taken through a polarizer filter. It shows that the blue sky is polarized, and as everybody knows, this is because the light from the sun is scattered by electrons binded to atoms in the high atmosphere, and scattered radiation acquires polarization properties. The same happens in the cosmic microwave background photons, which are blast scattered at recombination. And in number 46, you see that there are two ways to produce polarization in the cosmic microwave background. The physical process is, of course, Thomson scattering of photons from free electrons at recombination. And the pattern, the resulting pattern, depends, the polarization degree is non-zero only if the incoming photons has a quadruple anisotropy. So there are two ways to produce this quadruple anisotropy. One is the motion of electrons at recombination due to overdensities and underdensities in the primary plasma. The other way is the presence of gravitational waves which are a generic prediction of all inflation theory. So these waves can propagate even in the primordial plasma and produce a very distinctive pattern, very faint but very distinctive pattern of polarization in the cosmic microwave background. In slide number 47, you see the polarization map, which was measured from Boomerang again in 2003, simply adding polarizers to the previous Boomerang experiment. We need to do better. And in slide number 48, you see that the WMAP experiment has done a lot in this sense. Here you see the, on the left the process which produces polarization due to density fluctuations and the resulting velocities of the electrons which scatter CMB photons at recombination. And these patterns, which as you see from the top and the bottom panel, are either tangential or radial, so are zero curl patterns, and they are called E-modes. This pattern has been measured, in fact, by the WMAP experiment, and now has been measured even better by the Planck experiment. So this confirms this basic theory of the scattering of photons from free electrons at recombination. But the measurements of WMAP and of Planck are not sensitive enough to measure the other component of this polarization pattern, which is B-modes. And in slide 49, you see that E-modes have the symmetry core properties I've said before. B-modes have different properties because they are generated by gravitational waves, which have different symmetries. And B-modes have a curve pattern. So while density fluctuation cannot produce B-modes, gravitational waves can produce B-modes. In slide number 50, you see a collection of measurements of polarization in the cosmic microwave background. And the top panel is the cross-correlation between polarization and anisotropy, and you see that the data follow very well the prediction. Also in the middle panel, where there is the polarization itself, the E-modes of polarization, you see again that the data already follow the model. And if you look at the left scale, you see that these signals are very small. The signals are in microkelvin square, and we are around 1 microkelvin square. For the B-modes, which is the bottom panel, we have only upper limits. No one has been able to measure the B-modes yet. And as you see, the theory depends, of course, on the energy scale of inflation, but the level of B-modes, the forecast is very, very low. In the slide number 52, you see a simple formula which relates the amplitude of B-modes to the energy scale of inflation. So doing this research, if we were able to detect B-modes, we would be able to set the energy scale of inflation. This is the hope of the cosmology community at this point. What should we do to do this, to measure really the energy scale of inflation? First of all, slide number 54, we have to improve the sensitivity of the instrument. So we need to go in space, we need to use cryogenic system, and large arrays of millimeter wave detectors. In slide 55, you see one of these instruments is the IDEX, the Hubble telescope. It looks a lot like a boomerang, but the number of detectors here is much larger. Number 56, you see that the focal plane contains about 700 detectors. In boomerang, we had originally 16 detectors. But this is not enough. There is only one problem which must be solved. We must have more sensitivity. Then we need to control systematic effects. And this is described in slide number 57. And in slide number 57, you see that the systematic effects we have to fight, the main way to fight systematic effects into itself a polarization modulator. And this is not present in Planck, was not present in WMAP, nor in Boomerang. So I think I have to skip a number of slides now and go directly to number 70. In this framework, we plan to refly Boomerang again with new detector arrays, which are provided by Leonid and this group, and a new polarization modulator. And we have selected a set of two frequencies to measure. One is 150 GHz, which is the maximum of the signal from the cosmic microwave background. But the other one, very important, is 340 GHz, where we measure the polarization due to interstellar dust. Since the B-modes are so small, they are contaminated by the galactic signal. So we need to measure the galactic signal in polarization at the frequency near to the maximum of the signal. And the best frequency is 340 GHz. So with this experiment, we do a map of interstellar dust polarization, and we validate this new kind of detectors, the called the electrophotometers produced by Leonid, which are the candidates for the new mission for CMB polarization. And also we insert a polarization modulator, a cold polarization modulator in the instrument. So in slide 71, you compare the previous focal plane of Boomerang with just 8 pixels, with the new focal plane of Boomerang with more than 100 pixels. In slide number 72, you see the concept of the cold electrophotometers for Boomerang. I skip this because Leonid knows much better than me what is all this about, but I want to stress the fact that this is a really a key technology, not only for Boomerang, but also for a number of other experiments, and finally for a space experiment. The polarization modulator we are planning to include in Boomerang is based on a rotating coupling plate and a polarizer. It is a classical Stokes polarimeter, but includes has to be cold to remove the problems of the emission of the halfway plate. And also we have to find the problems of the chromatism of the halfway plate. As you can see, number 75, the halfway plate is can be made either with a direct ingent crystal, and this has been done with some success by the group of Cardiff and Manchester. In slide number 77, you see an example of the retarded bead with many meshes, so that has a flat response over the range from 100 to 200 to 200 GHz. And in slide 78, you see the other approach, which is the reflective halfway plate, which is made of a polarizer and a mirror, so that the two polarizations are shifted exactly like at the wavelength. This happens at several frequencies. With boomerang wheel, we have not decided which of the two systems to use, but already we have produced a cryogenic rotator, which is shown in slide number 880, where you can see this mechanical system, which is able to rotate a Dirac-Ninja crystal at 2 Kelvin with a power dissipation less than 10 millivolts when it's rotated. All this will go inside the new boomerang experiment, slide 81, and you see the general is the same as the previous one. The telescope is still the same, the cryostat is still the same, but with new detectors and new polarization modulator. Last, I want to show slide 82 flights which can be made from the Svalbard, Spitzbergen Island. This is the trajectory of a flight we made in 2007 with a small balloon. And you see that the situation is symmetric to what happened in Antarctica. There is a stratospheric circulation during the summer, which allows you to launch the experiment from Svalbard to modify Greenland and then the Arctic Ocean, and then come back again over Svalbard and then to recover the instrument in Greenland. So this is the flight we plan to use for boomerang, because Svalbard are much easier to access with a regular flight to Longyearbyen than Antarctica. So I hope I have summarized what I wanted to do and have been in time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Paolo. Thank you very much, Paolo, for the very interesting presentation. Sorry, colleagues, we've lost some slides of the presentation here. And however, this talk is open for discussions, for questions. And my first question, as a member of organizing committee of this meeting, concerned of a possibility to use your presentation. We want to install this presentation to the site of Leonid Kuzmin's laboratory. Is it possible, Paolo?
Oh yes, you take the PDF file I sent you and you can use it as you like.
Thank you very much. However, more questions, colleagues? Please. Gregory Goldsman, please.
Hello, Paolo. I have a question hello. For you, but probably you cannot see me.
No, I can't.
No, camera not switched on. No,
okay. Switch up.
Microphone is switched on, but no camera.
No camera, okay. Let me introduce myself. My name is Gregory Goldsman. We met last time in Palermo on the Limitron meeting.
Yes.
Okay, so my question is about size of transparent universe. I see in your presentation something in giga-light years. But you know, there are a lot of students here, and I believe that it is more understandable if you can translate that into meters. How many orders of magnitude we can imagine that this transparent universe is?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the last part of your question, but I imagine is how much is 14 billion light years in meters, right?
In meters, right.
I see. Okay.
It's Leonid. I had some figure. I multiply the speed of light on this age for 10 billion. And it was this fantastic figure. This is the power of 24.
Yeah, it's a lot. 23 is incredibly large.
Okay, thank you very much.
But what I want to stress is the fact that there is more behind the, this firewall. This is really a firewall. There is this unit of photoprojections. If we use the photons, but if we use gravitational waves, neutrinos, for example, we can go behind this firewall. And while we are waiting for efficient detectors for gravitational waves and neutrinos, and this will not come very soon, we can do something with the cosmic microwave background, because as I explained, the gravitational waves will come from much farther away. They produce a pattern in the cosmic microwave background. And the boomerang experiments, but also other experiments, are really wanted to detect this pattern.
Thank you very much, Paolo.
Thank you again. More questions, colleagues? No more questions. Thank you very much again.
Thank you. I wish you
thank you, colleagues. Now we finished with our scientific part of this talk, and now maybe some некоторые объявления оргкомитета. Прошу.
Уважаемые коллеги, сейчас объявляется перерыв, но мы так планируем, что где-то минут.